Greetings, ladies and gents, and welcome to this latest version of Tales from Outer Space, where I take an HUPY story from somewhere around the internet and read it aloud for your enjoyment. All the relevant links are down below. Like, subscribe, and all that YouTube gumph to help this video and channel grow. Anyways, as always, I hope that you enjoy. I would just like to thank the following Tier 5 patrons and channel members for supporting the channel. Data Magnet, and Bob the Dragon. Thank you again, and now on to the story. Pretty Little Death Worlders, the ultimate sacrifice. Cheers erupted across all of Sol as the craft's central engines died. Marsova sank into her command chair. A tremendous weight had just been lifted off her shoulders. She, of righteous fury, chirped her own approval, and gave Marsova a reassuring pat on the shoulder with one gigantic forelimb. Aboard the craft, things were not nearly so jubilant. War Queen Pyamirani had sunk into her own command chair, but out of despair, not relief. She listened to her advisors explain their situation with mounting dread and disbelief. "Dismise," said FG-9982, the engineering advisor. "We are stuck. We do not have an easy way to fix the situation. The odds of a dark engine just vanishing out of reality are slim to begin with, and coupled with the amount of matter which would be required to make an engine the size of the crafts disappear, we assume it would just never happen. We don't have spare engine core of that size. That means that we can't recharge, because there isn't anything to recharge." "We do have spare engine cars for the auxiliary engines," added Nalperit, the manufacturing advisor. "But they are not big enough to take the place of the central engine car. Making a new car can be done, but it would take time." "Time we do not have," Marani replied. She sighed deeply. "Well, my counsel, this is a disaster beyond words. Unless someone comes up with a truly brilliant plan, and believe me, I'm trying my best. This could well be the end of us. It has been an honor to be your war queen." The room fell silent. Everyone present racked their brains for a suitably brilliant plan. "Well, if our last fears, we could detonate the auxiliary engines. It'd probably do a lot of damage to the planet Blue. A final fuck you to the Stellar League. I like it." "We're not gonna do that," Marani snapped. "But it is kind of amusing to think about." Back Commander Kull was becoming increasingly frustrated. First Hermes, as he was now calling himself, had gone missing. Then a bounty had been put on his head. Then the whole crew had been put in quarantine, which seemed to mostly consist of propaganda sessions. The door to the secure chamber slid open violently, and a group of heavily armed guards marched in. The pack captain scoured the room with his eyes, which eventually settled on Kull.
"Pack Commander Kull, War Queen Pyamirani has ordered that you be sentenced to death for treason. Do you have anything to say before your sentence is carried out?"
There was a pause, and then an uproar. The entire crew of the insert name here was on their feet in seconds, yelling and snarling in the pack commander's defense. The guards pointed their weapons around the room, but it didn't quell the fury. Weeks of frustration were bubbling over all at once. Kull felt her heart race. Treason? Oh yes, she had given up the comm codes, but that had been part of the deal to get them all out of there. Now she was to die for it. She took some deep, steadying breaths and raised one paw to silence her crew. They didn't listen.
"Sorry, Pack Commander," Little Eight said over the chaos, "but we're not going to let you walk to your death. Not after all of this."
"There is no reason for you all to die too," Kull shouted back.
The pack captain pulled out his sidearm and pointed it at Kull.
"Those last words will do. I will note them down."
Before he could fire, however, the lights in the room flickered and died. It was a great shudder throughout the entire structure of the craft. The crew took this as their opportunity and leapt at the armed guards as one great mass. Destroyer crews could number close to 500, and this particular crew were bound together more tightly than most thanks to their odd experiences. They moved as one.
The guards fired their weapons, striking true at many moments, but in seconds they were overrun. Cal roared and leapt into the fray itself. By the time the lights came back on, only the crew of the insert name was left standing. Lucky Ears groaned.
We're in deep shit, aren't we?
Absolutely, Cal replied. Move the fallen to honorable positions while I figure out what to... There was a horrible scraping sound as one of the sealed maintenance tunnels had its grate forced off. Hermes crawled out. He was far skinnier than he'd been when Cal had last seen him. But he was alive.
Oh no, did they already show up?
Little Aids gave Hermes a tackle hug, knocking him into the wall. Cal smiled, despite the situation.
Let the technician go, Little Aids. Hermes, anything to report?
Well, I was about to report that they were going to execute you, though I think you already got that message back, Commander.
Indeed. Did you cut the lights?
No. Hermes pursed his lips in thought for a moment. I actually have no idea what that was about. Crosspulse, a comm technician who had once worked on the INH's bridge, cocked his head and listened intently.
Something's wrong. The humming sound that we had heard earlier died when the lights died. What was making that noise?
Hermes scratched his chin.
Could have been the main gun, but if it stopped without firing...
No way! Little Eight's eyes went wide.
Did something happen to the main engine that would take out the power and stop the gun?
Cull went cold.
Did they somehow destroy our engine core? Technicians, could the League do that to our main gun?
Given that they haven't told us what they did to our ship's engines, Hermes replied, I'm gonna go with possibly. And if they did, then the craft can't even recharge from a local star.
Many members of the crew who had heard this discussion suddenly looked very uncomfortable. After all, not everyone was quite on board with the interspecies friendship as Hermes and Cull were. To a majority of the lost, this situation sounded like a species-wide death sentence. The craft hung limply just outside of the Martian atmosphere. Her auxiliary engines were keeping her in a stable orbit. Though many Martians became very paranoid that she would get closer and squash them flat. Lost ships swarmed around the false moon like ants guarding their nest. Getting them out of the way was going to be a problem.
We need to land our transport ships before the last do something stupid, Mustafa explained, such as detonating their remaining engines and roasting Mars just to spite us.
Would they really do that? The Queen Admiral asked.
Well, a human would consider it.
Ah, point taken. Yes, sir. We must hurry and clear a path.
The forces of the League exited the asteroid belt en masse, going straight for the craft. They descended like a horde of locusts. Martian ground defenses provided cover for them, taking out as many ships that got too close to the planet's surface. In the distance, transport ships loomed. It was the largest ground invasion force in history. Any present species history, albeit only because the last weren't much for invasions. Aboard one transport vessel was an infamous Captain Singh. He had expected to be called upon to secure uninhabited worlds for humanity as they went to space. He hadn't expected this. As the ships descended and the battle raged, the new broadcast cut from the silence of space. The last probably would have ignored it if it hadn't been labeled For War Queen Pia Morani. Such a message had to be brought to the War Queen on penalty of death. Even then, Morani probably would have ignored it if she hadn't been faced with the end of a species. It was a two-way broadcast offer. The League wanted to talk, and Morani didn't have anything better to do as a species died. She accepted the call. The image of Ambassador Miki Yamada appeared in a personal comm screen.
Am I speaking to War Queen Pia Morani?
Yes, I assume that I am speaking to Ambassador Miki Yamada.
Indeed.
Have you come to taunt me?
Not at all.
Yamada's alien expression was hard to read, but she seemed a little tense.
I am offering you terms of surrender.
Terms denied! Really, after all this time, you think you can persuade us to be meekly herded to our extermination? We'll fight to the last.
What if we weren't planning to exterminate you? Humans have caused genocides and extinctions in our past, and we've decided to never let it happen again. And as for the rest of the League, well, they're all a peaceful civilizations. None of us want to wipe you out. We just want you to stop wiping us out. Mirani barked along, hoping that it wouldn't come across as nervous as it was. Yamada sighed. War Queen, I have absolutely no reason to believe that you are foolish or stupid. You are evidently held in a very high regard by your people, and I am sure that you must have earned that regard. I know that generations of xenophobic beliefs are hard to shed. Human history has taught me that much. Please think about this rationally. We have insisted on disabling, not destroying your ship at every turn. We sent you back to the crew of the insert name here, and they told you how we treated them. And more importantly, I represent a body of 12 sapient species that have been cooperating with each other for centuries. Do you not find the possibility that I'm being truthful to be even slightly plausible? The flicker of doubt arose once more in Morani's chest. What if? What if?
Just out of curiosity, what would those terms of surrender be, exactly?
Hope glimmered in Yamada's eyes. Firstly, demilitarization. Secondly, you and your council would be tried for crimes against life. You'd be given a fair trial, of course, but I have to admit that I can't see it ending well for you. Thirdly, we have identified an uninhabited planet that appears to be suitable to your physiology. The craft would be towed into its orbit as a new moon, and you would be given the tools to colonize it. Your species would be given a fresh start. If, in generations to come, you reach the stars once more and have become peaceful, you'll be welcomed to the League. Samarani's own death was assured, and the rest of his species would have a pretty hard time of it for quite a while.
And if I say no,
we'll still do all of those things, but we'll have to invade and take control of the craft, which will undoubtedly involve quite a bit of bloodshed.
Bloodshed, yes, of course it will. There's not a person aboard this craft, save maybe those traitors who wouldn't fight to the end to protect our people. And I suspect that if I surrender, I will be murdered and my successor will continue this war. Even if you can worm your way into the heads of one or two people, you can't convince us all. I refuse to be remembered as a coward.
Yamada was taken aback by this. I assume that this negotiation is over then.
We will go into history with honor, Mickey Yamada. I only hope that when your time comes, you find it in yourself to do the same. Cut the feed.
End of chapter.
And that, my friends, concludes this video. I hope that you enjoyed, and if you do, please consider supporting the author, even by popping over and leaving a thumbs up or a nice comment, just to show your appreciation for the story. However, if you wish to support this channel, there are links down below which will help immensely. I will see you all in the next one, and until then, I hope that you have a fantastic day. Cheers.